1959. Come from Chibi in the Eastern region, and married to Professor Angela Ofori-Atta. We have three children.
May I interrupt here? Is Ken Ofori-Atta your full name, or are there any you're leaving out?
Kenneth Nanayao Kuntun Kununku Ofori-Atta. That's a full name.
Very well. Now you may proceed.
We have four children, three biological and one adopted. Started school in Chibi Government School, and then came to Newtown Experimental in Accra. Went to University Primary School in Lagon, and Achimota Primary School. Finished Achimota Primary in 1971. I think I was in the same class as in primary school as the former President Mahama, and went to Achimota Secondary School, did my O and A levels, went to Columbia College in New York for a bachelor's in economics, 1980 to 84, and then the Yale School of Management, 1986 to 1988. I worked the summer of 83 at the Federal Trade Commission in Washington, D.C., and when I finished college in 84, I worked in Morgan Stanley on Wall Street for 2 years before going to Yale School of Management. After the Yale School of Management, came back to Wall Street and worked with Salomon Brothers through 1990. In 1990, returned to Ghana with Kelly Gajapo and Togwe Afede, and founded Data Bank Financial Services, where I worked for, well, through 2012 as co-founder and executive chairman. Resigned in 2012 and as executive chairman, and founded a small company called Family Ventures to begin to look at the holdings we had acquired over that period, and then finally resigned from doing anything with Data Bank in 2014, and proceeded to participate in politics, becoming the director of fundraising for the New Patriotic Party. So in between 1990 and when I retired, we did a lot of investments, including acquisition of banks in Liberia and the Gambia, and also acquired controlling interest in Enterprise Insurance. And I was on the board of various banks and finance institutions. But I was also particularly interested in education, and therefore served on the boards of Yale University, Central University College, Ashesi, University of Ghana Advisory, and also was the chair of the University of Ghana Agriculture and Consumer Science Department. So that's a brief presse. Thank you.
Great. Other members, anybody who wants to ask a question on CV, you have one opportunity, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, if you look at the communications from His Excellency the President to Parliament, number three, Mr. Ken Ofori-Atta, Minister for Finance. On the CV, we have Kenneth Nanaya Ofori-Atta. Honorable Nomi has just told us that his name is Nanaya Kuntun Kununkun Ofori-Atta. What is your name? And are you the Ken Ofori-Atta, the president nominated and referred to Parliament for consideration?
Yes. Why are you representing your bless you.
Mr. Chairman, I have the same issues of the president being called William, but I am Kenneth. Nanayao Kuntunkrunko Ofori-Atta. I typically sign my name Ken Ofori-Atta.
I think that the communication from the presidency omitted some names, and then he himself was asked to submit his CV, and he decided to hide the Kuntunkrunko. For what reason? Mr. Chairman asked him of the official name, and he added Kuntunkrunko.
I think that he did ask me for my full name, but in my passport is Kenneth Nanayao Ofori-Atta.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. It will be difficult to do one if you will allow me. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, the first page, permit me to congratulate the nominee, Honorable Kenneth Nanayao Kuntunkrunko Ofori-Atta. I like the Ghanaianness of the name. There seemed to be a gap in the CV between 1978 and 1980 that has not been accounted for. Can we be told what the nominee was up to between 1978 and 1980?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. That is true, and that was the period in which I had finished Achimota School. I taught for about a year and a half at Accra Academy, and prepared myself to go to America for college. That accounts for that period. So I started college in 1980. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Page 1 has your employment history, and you indicate that you work with the Federal Trade Commission, Washington, D.C., as a summer analyst in 1983. And I noticed that you were still pursuing your bachelor's at Columbia between 1980 and 1984. How long were you on this, and was it a real job or just one of those vacation summer jobs that did not really take you away from your studies?
That's correct. It was a summer vacation job.
So, Chairman, on page 2 of the CV, we do appreciate specific time periods. This committee will normally request that you give us the specific periods of your endeavors. And the leadership positions, you only state current. Trust Bank Limited, Data Bank Agri-Fund Manager Limited, SME Agribusiness, Bank of Kigali, and then you have previous. But you don't give us the specific durations, the periods of these engagements. Are you able to furnish the committee with the specific periods, if you have them?
Mr. Chairman, I should be able to. I've been of Trust Bank as a chairman since about 2000. And I'm yet to resign from that. Data Bank Agri-Fund, that has been since 2012, and now yet to retire from that, resign. And the Bank of Kigali in Rwanda, since a couple years ago, and that is also, I'm yet to resign from that, which I should do. The previous appointment, Data Bank Financial Services, it's 1990 to 2012. Enterprise Group, about 1998 through 2014. International Bank of Liberia, resigned in 2014. Acumen Fund also resigned in 2014.
Please, can you help us with same and the previous presentation, representation on social boards?
Mr. Chairman, TechnoServe International was about 1990.
Honorable.
I could actually.
Minister for Finance Designate. May I remind you that in a few weeks, you'll be required to, if you're not.
Something else going on. You do list a number of sporting activities you engaged in, but you prefer to keep it under leadership experience. School athletics and cricket team, college colors for track team, sprint, long and triple jumps, intramurals, soccer and volleyball. Will you describe these as leadership experience that you were acquiring? I want to understand why we find it under this column and not somewhere else. Yeah, in school. So leadership experience in school. I mean, I'm okay with entertainment prefect. I'm okay with coordinator, minority students interest group. But the sporting activities, I'm not too sure if that's exactly what you want to communicate.
I mean, I could recategorize them if you choose to. But school athletics in Achimota was school captain. That's why it is there. Columbia, I was captain of the jumping team, so that's why that's also there. Intramural soccer and volleyball at Yale, I also was captain of those.
Okay,
thank you.
Abu Obiamua, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Congratulations, Finance Minister Designate. We know you as Ken, so it's difficult saying Kenneth. Ken Ofori-Atta. Yes, I've looked at your CV.
Which I have published. And then with regards to professional bodies, I mean, since I decided to leave the financial industry, I also really resigned from most things to concentrate on the assignment that I had the past 2 years or so.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Permit me to get some clarification on your CV as it relates to the school that you attended, Yale School of Management. And this is necessary because I must put on record, even though the chairman of the committee quite explained it well to us earlier, the fact that the CVs got to us only late yesterday afternoon. If it had come earlier, perhaps I would have done some follow-ups to get myself the information. But I want the clarification from you since you are here. Now, I see that you indicate on the CV that between 1986 to 1988, you had an MBA in finance in Yale School of Management. A basic check I have done shows that between the period that you indicated that you were in that school, the school was actually called School of Organization and Management. And at the time, it conferred MPPM. That is the master's degree in public-private management, and introduced the MBA programs only in 1999. Now, you indicate here that you got the MBA in finance between 1986 and 1988, and per my basic check, that was before the MBA program was introduced in the school.
Thank you very much. It's essentially an MBA school, when it was changed, they then wrote to all alumni to ask whether we wanted our degrees changed to MBA or to keep the MPPM. And that's what really happened. And I chose to have it as an MBA because it's easier to explain. But I did go to that school specifically because of interest in public and private management. The issue being, how do you use techniques and models in the private sector if you happen to move to the public sector for that? Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe just in the same vein, you also indicated that you were an alumni of the alumni board of the same school between 1988 and 1990. I did a basic check also, and I saw the board of members as published on the website of the school. Your name was missing. That's the SOM alumni board. That's on page 2, between 1988 and 1990.
I was a member of the alumni board of SOM.
Yes, so that's what I'm saying. Because I did not have time to write to the school,
okay,
and I just did this basic check and noticed that they published the names of all the alumni, at least those that I could, you know, find,
mm-hmm,
and it was captured in different years, but your name was missing. That's the point I'm making. Have you noticed that, and have you made attempt for that to be rectified? Because this is on their website.
Okay. I haven't made an attempt to do that, but that was the alumni board, not the council board, so I don't know which one.
I was actually referring to the alumni board.
Yes. I was a member.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. Ujo, I'll come to you.
Thank you, Chairman. Honorable Minister Designate for Finance, looking at your CV, I see you having, you and your business partners having started Damsel with $25,000 and establishing a fund of a size $264 million today. And at the same time, seeing the CV that there is very little emphasis on educational qualification, you seem to come across as someone who did not pursue education and qualification and that line, but rather hands-on business enterprise development. Is that correct?
I'm not too clear about the question. I'm sorry. I did not pursue...
Your emphasis in life as achiever placed more emphasis on hands-on business development rather than pursuit of academic qualifications. Is that correct?
I did an undergrad degree, and then I also have an MBA or MPPM, and I left it at that. There are too many PhDs in our family, so I stopped between my wife and my father. Thank you very much.
Minister of Finance Designate, let me take you back to your CV and to the first page. Achimota Secondary School, Accra, Ghana, Common Entrance Examinations, 1971-78. Did you write a Common Entrance at Achimota School?
I'm sorry, that should be at Achimota Primary School.
Please explain, because beneath that is also O and A levels. No. Common entrance, and into bracket beneath, or no?
Common entrance comes down to Achimota Primary, and O and A levels remain.
Very well. Take note of the correction and resubmit it to us.
Mr. Chairman, I just want a harmless follow up on Honorable Suhini's question. Honorable nominee, in answering the question posed by the Honorable Suhini on this MBA certificate. You said that after some years, the university recalled the certificates and issued MBA. They wrote to you.
What I said, sir, is that once they transformed it into an MBA, they asked us to choose whether you wanted your old MPPM certificate or you want it as an MBA certificate.
Was the new certificate backdated?
You know, I never read the thing, but it would be certainly the year you graduated. They can't.
Now, looking at the date you have provided here, it creates the impression that the new certificate was backdated, and that is what is creating the suspicion I'm having now.
Well, I mean, I can order the certificate to show you, but they will make it the year in which you graduated.
That is the end of the questions on. Sorry.
He attended Yale School of Management. And casually checks also you have Yale University. What is the relationship between his school and the university, Yale University? Is there any relationship?
Yale University has a number of programs. So you will get a degree from the college, you could get a degree from forestry, you could get a degree from the School of Management, etc. And so that's how it is done.
Very well. That is the end of issues relating to the CV. Now we'll go into the substantive matters. Honorable Ayaga, I'll start from you.
Thank you very much, Chairman. And let me congratulate Kenneth Nanaya Ofori-Atta for the nomination. Kuntunku. I think it is for good reason that he left it out. Congratulations. A few days ago, I think you were part of a delegation that met Moroccan investors, and at that meeting, you promised to ensure the passage of a fiscal responsibility act. If that is correct, I want to find out whether you are familiar with the Public Financial Management Act of 2016, Act 921, which this Parliament passed, and which Parliament of Ghana passed, and which has a whole section starting from section 12 to 18, and which deals with macroeconomic and fiscal policies. I want to find out whether you are familiar with this act and fiscal responsibility issues that it you are familiar with it. Yes, so I want to be sure that the chairman is permitting me to do follow-up questions before he says that's my second question. Okay. If you look at the Public Financial Management Act, It deals, in my opinion, with all the issues that will be captured by any fiscal responsibility legislation. If you are somewhat familiar with the Act, are there any inadequacies in this Act that the one that you are proposing to bring to Parliament will come and address?
I think, Mr. Chairman, the one key issue that we have discussed on a manifesto basis was establishment of the council, such that there will be closer attention to it. But, I mean, in looking at the Act, especially 70 through 80, I do see the rigor in that.
In terms of improving on our fiscal responsibility legislation is to add a council to it. That's the only innovation you are bringing.
Well, that I'm not bringing that. The party manifesto has said it's necessary to make sure that we follow it assiduously and it has teeth.
But are you convinced that the Act passed by Parliament has that serious shortcoming that you as Minister for Finance, if we approve, will be addressing? Are you personally convinced that this legislation has that shortcoming, is such a serious matter that you will be dealing with? Because the legislation has a lot of sanctions provided for non-compliance with any of the steps that is required, either in the budgeting process, in expenditure management, in everything. I mean, if you take a look at it, it deals with almost every issue, has clear sanctions. And so for me, are you really convinced that there's a need for any additional legislation on fiscal responsibility in Ghana?
Mr. Chairman, I think when at least I look at our current state of public finances, I suspect we need tighter monitoring and control. And I don't think that would hurt. If we can do this, we might never need the IMF. I am convinced that it will be helpful and not take away from making the Act that Parliament has passed stronger in execution. Thank you.
Three options. Oh, Chairman, I spoke about, I asked whether you permitted me to, no, please. Okay. Let me ask a last convoluted question in order to go around the chairman. The party manifesto proposes to abolish a number of taxes, reducing the corporate tax, removing import duties on raw materials and machinery for production, abolishing the special import levy, abolishing the 17.5 VAT on imported medicines not produced in the country, abolishing the 17.5% VAT on financial services, abolishing the 5% VAT on real estate sales, abolishing the 17.5% VAT on domestic airline tickets, reducing VAT for micro and small enterprises, and then imposing a 3% flat that was introduced previously by the Kufuor-led MPP government. I look at all these taxes, and it is taxes that are normally paid by people in a certain economic category. And you are proposing to take away those taxes and leave, because people of a certain class enjoy certain services. and you are leaving the general VAT on goods, which is largely consumed by poor people and people of a certain lower social standing. And before you came a nominee for the post of senior minister, and he said the tax base will expand, which in my opinion meant that broadened, which in my opinion meant that many of the poor people in the informal sector who have somehow been escaping paying taxes will all be roped in. These taxes, will you admit, will further deepen the divide between the rich and the poor, and make the rich richer and then the poor poorer by imposing more economic burdens on them? And lastly, if you take out these taxes, have you considered the financial implications?
Have you calculated that? The first part of
thank you, Mr. Chairman. Honorable Member, I don't consider this tax to be regressive or aimed at the poor to make them worse off. I've never actually thought about that. I think what I worry about with the poor is how we can continue to have such egregious poverty in this country. And what is the best way to be able to ensure that we up the living standards of everyone? I think as a party, I have seen keen interest in education and national health, and I will not presume that the underlying trigger for this is to make them worse off. I think the issue of paying taxes is something that we all have to do as citizens, and it is important that we all recognize responsibility of citizenhood. But at the same time, if we look at the totality of the manifesto, I think we would agree that there's quite a bit of stimulus that we are redirecting to the ground, as you may call it. So I don't see it that way, sir.
Congratulations, Ken. Mr. Chairman, the National Liberation Council Decree 326 mandates the Ghana Standard Board, now Ghana Standard Authority, the mandate to ensure that institutions of state that have measuring instruments to conform to the metrological instrument of the Standard Authority. I'm saying this because when you go to the Jubilee Fields, the Standard Authority currently don't have any machine that monitors the production of the oil from that fields. Mr. Chairman, I'm speaking as a former deputy ranking member, where that is the problem of the authority. I want to find out from Mr. Ken Ofori-Atta, when you are given the nod by this committee, are you prepared to support Ghana Standard Authority to establish this laboratory so that we can really track the production of these oil from the field? Currently, they are not monitored it. And we need to know, because we need revenue from this oil production for developmental purposes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for the question. I think the issue of metrology lab, I guess is what it might be, is something that we have to do. I mean, the purpose really of the ministry is to ensure financial accountability and to be able to track all of our revenues as a country. And not to be able to determine the oil that is being exported cannot be a good way of managing and protecting our assets. I'll be one of the first to support the establishment of such a laboratory. And I think it goes through all of our natural resources, including even cocoa and the mining industry, determining clearly what it is that they export. And we need to be vigilant about that. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, we have this problem where newly trained teachers and nurses for about 2 years or more have a problem of their salaries. I want to find out from the nominee, should he be giving the nod? Are we going to have a departure from that problems that these professionals have been going through for 2 years and 3 years? They'll be teaching, they'll be in the hospitals working, and they are not being paid. Yet, we're expecting them to give their best to this country. Are we going to have a departure when you are giving the nod?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. The straight answer is yes, because we have, even in our own manifesto, committed to payment of trainee nurses and trainee teachers. And these are about 120,000 of them that we intend to restore the 400 to 500 CDs a month when they are in school. Education is such a crucial part of where we want to go as a country, and I don't think we can begin to shortchange teachers who then improve the human resource capacity that we have. So we'll do all we can to ensure that the social contract that we have with such teachers will be maintained.
Mr. Chairman, my final question. What financial engineering do you have in mind to secure the manifesto pledge of the New Patriotic Party to establish the one district, one factory, the inner city Zongo development, the $1 million to one constituency, the Coastal Development Authority? What financial engineering do you intend to do to make sure we are able to fulfill this pledge to the good people of this country? Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. It does sound like a tall order, but if you look at the current profile that we have of our expenditure, we spend about maybe 15% of our revenue, about $1.6 billion, on capital expenditure. So for me, the issue of, let's say, getting $275 million reallocated to the constituencies sets the ground floor to be able to do the one district, one factory. And the beauty of that is that you are now looking at empowering the constituencies and all the districts for local problems with really local solutions in a way in which you then would have decentralized development to make sure that we do not shortchange anybody. So the resources are there through efficiency and vigilance. For the Zongo Development Fund, for example, we've targeted putting $50 million into that. There are about some 365 Zongos in the country. And it's really an issue of social justice. How do you have socioeconomic improvements in all of these areas? And I think we need to be clear that all citizens deserve a minimum threshold of livability. And that would be one of the main concerns as we develop this economy. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Honorable nominee, in the MPP manifesto, page 12.
Which version? It's a photocopy.
Page 12 is the version that you have, not the highlights. You identified some challenges and were very specific as to what you have seen among Ghanaians. I would like to draw your attention to some of the few things that you said here. Teachers are suffering. Teacher trainees are suffering. Nurses are suffering. Nursing trainees are suffering.
Yes.
Patients are suffering.
Yes.
Students are suffering.
Yes.
Traders are suffering.
Yes.
Pensioners are suffering.
Yes.
Drivers are suffering.
Yes.
Contractors are suffering.
Yes.
Civil servants are suffering.
Yes.
Farmers are suffering.
Yes.
Fishermen are suffering.
Yes.
Industries are suffering.
Yes.
Artisans are suffering.
Yes.
Kayaye are suffering.
Yes.
Men are suffering.
Yes.
Women are suffering.
Yes.
Children are suffering.
Yes.
Ghanaians are suffering.
Yes.
Honorable nominee, children are crying.
Yes.
Can you tell this committee what specific interventions you have in mind to alleviate the plight of men and children in this country? I'm limiting you to men and children. Specific interventions.
Like you, men like you.
I'm not very sure about the disadvantages of men, but children is a serious issue because that's our future, and so the question, not even being specific, is what do we do to get back the economy into a balance that we can all be proud of, and I think it's in a sense, how do we run this Ministry of Finance in a way in which we'll have a professional organization for economic development? How do we reposition ourselves so that there's quality financial accountability in what we do and our ability to be able to protect our revenue so we can target it to these people? So for me, if I look at the Ministry of Finance, for example, I see areas of risk management that we have not been quite vigilant about. I see it turning into a top-notch global treasury so that the issues of judgment debt, the issues of compensation, the issues of arrears and SOE debt are all things that we can track well to make sure we don't get into those problems. And it is from there that we can then allocate these resources to men and children in a vigilant way. thank you.
Honorable Minority Leader.
Yes, thank you, Chairman. I just have Honorable Minister Designate, can you end all those sufferings within 4 years?
Mr. Chairman, these are difficult issues and structural issues, but there's a lot we can do to alleviate. And my firm belief is that our manifesto seeks to address some of these issues. So yes, immediately, of course, is the issue of trainee nurses and trainee teachers, as an example. The intervention in the Zongos is an example. Bringing $1 million to the constituencies is also an example. Tackling it from the bottom and also making sure things like the common fund goes first to the district as opposed to deduction from Accra. So it's going to be Herculean, but it is for the reason why we are sitting here. We promise on God's honor to be able to do this.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, my second question has to do with a statement that the nominee made immediately after his nomination was announced. He stated that fuel prices were not going to be increased. I want to ask the honorable nominee, Under the regulation, what specific role can the Minister of Finance play to hold, not to increase price of fuel?
Mr. Chairman, it is deregulated, and so the market forces will prevail. In terms of being able to manage and or control that, really what we have now is an issue of huge legacy liabilities. And as long as those are there, the people who import will somehow be able to put prices on it to increase it. So ours is to make sure that we get rid of the legacy liabilities to ensure that the liberalized market holds. That is where we can influence that process.
Thank you very much. Mr. Chairman, my last question. During the campaign, there was this promise to the people of Brown Ahafo that customers of DKM, God is Love, Justa Motors, Perfect Edge, Little Drops, and several others will have their monies paid to them by government when the MPP wins elections. Now we have won. When are you going to pay them? Do you have any idea as to the quantum of money involved in this? And when are you going to pay?
Mr. Chairman, I'm not sure it's in our manifesto, and I'm not sure, therefore, who declared that all of that will be paid. But I know there's a certain process going on, which I'm not privy to all of that. And then I think we are also introducing some protection of deposits, which will go structurally to change that problem. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. The Honorable Ken Ofori-Atta, congratulations. I've just been looking at your CV, and I want to ask one question and then follow up with two other questions. It says you are the entertainment prophet at Hachimota School. And I have known you a little bit. I don't know how the form in which this entertainment was going on back in the days when you were in school, if you can shed more light on it.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not quite clear how to answer that, but I used to be a very active person in my time. Yeah, I was the entertainment prefect.
Okay, that's by the way. My more serious question has to do with the payment of feeding grants for northern schools. That comes directly under the Ministry of Finance. And you would agree that there has been challenges with that. I think that many will want assurances from your ministry if you eventually become, from you, if you eventually get to pass or get passed by this house. Many of the schools are still in arrears. Schools are not reopening, and many will attest. We want firm assurance that we will never go back to this problem because it really hurts education in the three northern regions.
Mr. Chairman, honorable member, I think I can give you my full assurance that I'll use all my best efforts to ensure that the issues of education, you know, are taken care of. I mean, we do have challenges with the common fund and insurance and SNET and pension, electricity, all to the tune of, you know, almost 1.2 billion that we have to take care of. But education should not be compromised. because I see myself as a great beneficiary of that. And fortunately, I was also able to go to a number of Kaki schools, and so I understand what it means to have good tuition and the opportunity to go further. Thank you.
Thank you. In the MPP's manifesto, His Excellency the President has talked about formalizing the economy in order to pursue his transformation agenda and also rapid increase in revenues. And my understanding is that that sits within the ambit of the finance ministry and other ministries to collaborate to ensure that this formalization happens immediately. What is the time frame for that?
Key issues with that, you know, just fall squarely on the issue of the national identification scheme, because that really is a basis for which we recognize the underserved and be able to target support for all of our people. So the national identification scheme, that one, there's a commitment to initiate it as soon as practicable, expecting that within a space of 12 to 18 months, that will be done. And I think that goes to the heart of the matter.
My last question, just one last. I see.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, my first question will be a question on a campaign promise that was made by then flag bearer, now His Excellency Nana Akufo-Addo, about paying all contractors who are owed on government books in the first 100 days. I want to find out from the Honorable nominee if that pledge, if that pledge still holds. It was widely reported.
By what? By less. By less than before.
Please, Mr. Chairman, that all contractors will be paid in the first 100 days.
Where?
The question is directed at me. Let him answer and skip up.
Mr. Chairman, I haven't heard that, but whether that promise was made or not. But as we look at our budget, we are still in the throes of trying to understand the quantum of our arrears. And so that will be the determining factor in going there. Yeah, lingering arrears are over 2 billion CDs from the little I have seen. The number sort of keeps changing. So I don't know specifically where that statement was made, but it is something we have to tackle. I mean, the social justice issue, as long as somebody has done good work, it is incumbent on us as a government to fulfill our part. And so we will treat it as decently as we'll treat anybody else we owe.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. But just to place on record that Ghana Web and Star FM Online on the 31st of October 2016, under the caption, MPP government will pay all contractual debt in 100 days, Nana Akufo-Addo, 31st October 2016. Addressing members of the Ghana Association of Road Contractors at the Ghana Institute of Engineers on Monday, the MPP presidential nominee said 90%
of the... Can you go on to your question,
okay,
please?
Thank you. Thank you. So I am glad that the finance minister nominee will take note and the Government Assurance Committee of this House will be watching closely.
It's the headline.
Oh, please. Don't mind. Well, Mr. Chairman, my second question has to do with the elaborate tax reliefs that have been promised on page 17 of the MPP manifesto. I want to find out the financial implication of all of these tax cuts have been considered, and if there is a figure to it. How much are you going to lose if you abolish all these taxes on page 17 of your manifesto? And how do you intend to fill the gap? Where will you get additional resources from to fill the gap when these taxes are abolished?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Honorable, that's an excellent question. And I don't look at it as how much we are going to lose, because I really look at it as a stimulus. And that changes my perspective on how we're going to tackle that. You know, in sort of the little time one has had to work with the transition program and what we have seen so far, it is quite clear to me that, A, if we really, as an economy, get a little bit of growth from the 3%, let's say, to 5%, that is an expanded economy. That in itself, you know, will generate over $1 billion dollars or so for us. Now, the other issue we have is that we are seeing so many leakages, and it is recorded for all of us to know that those type of leakages could amount to about 1 to 5% of the GDP. Now, 5% of GDP, let's say, will be about $2 billion, and that's 8 billion Ghana cedis. And with that type of growth, or be able to stop that leakage, you know, it's quite a bit of resources for you. I think the Auditor General's report also, at some point, that indicate leakages of over 6 billion CDs that we can work with. And then a better management of the economy, meaning interest rates go down. We are currently spending over $2 billion in paying interest alone, and at the same time increasing our primary balance, which is negative, which means that it's debt upon debt. When you begin to relieve yourself of these, that's an incredible amount of money that we can save. So this is where the hope is for me, that if we focus the Ministry of Finance on financial accountability, be very vigilant using the new PFMA to push our agenda. The His Excellency the President has moved cocoa board, for example, into agriculture, and that's perfect for us because ours is to follow how we raise money and how we stop leakages. So, Honorable, I feel there's a lot of space to be able to do that, and the reductions for me is more of a stimulus and a challenge to make these things real. Thank you.